This podcast is sponsored by liveproducersonline.com, a community of Ableton Live users connecting you to the pros to learn today's music production. What's up, guys? This is your host, Dan Giffen, for the podcast. We have an amazing guest today, Laura Escudé. Before we get started, I wanted to give you an update with the website of liveproducersonline.com. We launched Project Feedback. So if you are a pro member, you can submit your projects once a month to the Project Feedback tab. And either myself or another experienced producer will give you video feedback on the projects you submit. So whether you need help mixing with the composition, you can upload your project file to the website once a month and get video feedback from myself or another producer. So that's for pro members. Check that out. Join the website. We've got a free or a basic membership. Basic gives you access to all video replays of webinars that we have. Pro members also can join live and watch replays, as well as lots of other good stuff. Check it out, liveproducersonline.com. Click the big fat join button. And now for today's podcast. Well, thanks everybody for joining another episode of the Ableton Live Music Producer Podcast. I am your host, Dan Giffen. And today we have an extra special guest that I am super, super excited about. We have Laura Escudé. Whether we're talking about music technology, performance, production and design, live performance, there are a few people in the world who understand the music industry and music technology like Laura. She is actually the first Ableton Live certified trainer in the world, as well as an artist, instrumentalist, a live show designer. She has a deep understanding of complex technology of all sorts. Laura has also worked with Kanye West, Jay-Z, Herbie Hancock, Miguel, Bon Iver, Porter Robinson, Silversun Pickups, Iggy Azalea, and I'm sure you've heard of a few of those. If not, you need to get out more often. Laura is also the CEO and founder of Electronic Creatives, a team of music programmers, show designers who design and implement cutting edge solutions for music performance. I could go on and on for another 12 hours just sharing her profile and her bio. Without further ado, thanks, Laura, for joining me today. I really appreciate it.
Awesome. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, we're going to have a good time.
What an intro. Wow. I'm just, wow. I was like,
I practiced.
You did.
Yeah, I ran through it a few times. I have a little note sheet and I was like editing it. Yeah, it was crazy.
Awesome.
Yeah, I'm sorry I missed you. We were actually like basically in the same neighborhood and didn't get to see each other this last week because of schedule conflicts and craziness. But yeah, LA is a beautiful place. And I believe that's where you still live right now, right?
Yeah, I'm based in LA. I've been here for the last 14 years, so.
It's a long time. You must really like it down there.
I do. I love it. It's the best.
It really is. Yeah, it was beautiful. I was down there for the Rose Bowl. Happy New Year, by the way.
Happy New Year. Yeah. Got some resolutions and just had a meeting with my business coach. We're like, yeah, we're going to get 2019.
Yeah. No, it's great. I stopped making resolutions and I just started calling them goals because I feel like it's easier to keep them when I call them goals. I don't know, for me personally. But
for sure. Yeah.
But yeah, no, that's great. Everybody needs to have goals and resolutions at some point.
Yeah,
and,
absolutely. Yeah, you know what? You're right. I'm doing goals too. I mean, yeah. I have goals all the time. So it's not need a new year to give me some extra goals, but
yeah,
it's a nice time to reset for sure.
Absolutely. Congratulations on the newer EP called Transmute.
Thank you.
Yeah, you came out with that in November. I encourage all the listeners to go check that out. It's really cool. The first song, Control, I really resonated with that. I was actually listening to it a couple weeks ago for the first time, and I started listening to the first song, Control, and I was like, I've heard this song. Like, definitely heard this song before, and I didn't know that was you. And I was like, oh, this is cool.
Oh, nice.
Good stuff. That's awesome.
That's cool. Yeah, it's been exciting to have new music out, and you may have heard it at Loop, actually, because they were playing participants' songs on the roof randomly. So like I actually walked on the roof one day and I heard Control and I was like, oh my gosh, someone knows that I'm here and they're just doing this to make me feel good.
That's awesome.
I was like, no, that was just like a random playlist that was just cycling through songs.
That's fantastic. Yeah, yeah, no, I encourage everybody to listen to it. It's really well produced. I like it. You obviously have a lot of experience, not only with just like producing in Ableton, but also like an instrumental background. I believe you play violin as well and some other instruments, right?
Yeah, violin, keys, vocals,
controller, yeah.
Obviously.
Yes, all those buttons. So yeah. That's, yeah. So tell us a little bit about your musical background. How did you get started in music and how did that lead you to where you're at today?
Well, So the short story is I started playing violin when I was 5 and saw a girl in my church playing, and I was like, I want to do that. Just fell in love with the instrument, played in orchestras and all that kind of stuff growing up. Went to school, to college for music and violin performance. And about halfway through, I got caught up in the rave scene. And I went from being a classical violinist to a raver.
Nice.
All in the course of one weekend.
Oh, wow.
But no, it was cool. And I just was exposed to electronic music for the first time. And I was like, wow, I need to do this. This is like, I'm feeling this. These are my people.
Yeah.
So I just started like playing violin over drum and bass music to start, which was a horrible idea. It was like the hardest style of electronic music I could try to play over. I was like, wow, this is fast.
Okay. It is. Yeah.
All electronic music at that time sounded the same to me. So I was like, I can't tell the difference between drum and bass and house and like downtown, you know, it just all sounded the same. So yeah. I kind of made it my mission to figure out, I was like, okay, what are the differences between these styles? Like, who are the players? Like, who, you know, how can I get involved? And I just started playing violin over DJ's music. And then that kind of progressed to, okay, well, how can I play violin on your song? And that kind of progressed to, well, how do I make the song? And then I was like, how do I actually, you know, record and make the song? And then how do I perform live? And
yeah.
So it just kind of kept progressing and learning more and more. And, you know, just along the way, just was like reading a lot of books and manuals and watching videos and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, that was the journey to starting to create electronic music.
That's awesome. I was stalking your bio on Wikipedia and some other forums and things, and it seems like you've put a lot of work into your career and like just doing what you love and staying curious and like constantly learning and growing and over the years. And you obviously have like a huge following online, and you do a lot of videos. You're teaching at Electronic Creatives, which I mentioned earlier. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that, what that is?
Electronic Creatives hasn't been an educational platform until this past year, but
Okay. We
do live show programming for artists. So, for example, like I toured with Kanye for 7 years, and through that I started building up my roster. And so what we do is we service artists that are performing live, and we do all of their live show programming and playback. So artists and their management will come to us and say, we want to hire one of your team to come on the road with us. So that's what EC is. Yeah. So Okay. It's more like we're the hands, we're the ears in the background of all these live shows, making it happen for the artist, but we're not actually training the artist what we do. Cause you know, artists right. like Kanye, he's like, yeah. just make it happen. I don't care how you do it. Just do it. You
make
know?
Me look good and I'll worry about my own stuff. Yeah.
So, but it's interesting with the teaching thing, because, you know, I was teaching kind of very early on, and then I started doing the touring stuff, and that took over. And then I started training people to do what I do in the touring world. So, and then started like building my team and doing more of that. And it's kind of come full circle in a way, because now it's like, you know, I have this team and we're out there on the road doing different shows, and then I'm training more people to join the team. And so, yeah, it's a really cool, like symbiotic relationship between our clients and then people that want to get into the industry and learn what I'm doing. And, you know, I just have been really blessed because some amazing people have come across my path, and I've been like, hey, you have good vibes. You got good energy. You're musical, you're technical, got good communication. All right, come join my team.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. So how did you get started when you first launched Electronic Creatives? Like, how did that come about, I guess? Was it kind of just an organic process of like you started offloading the work you were doing to other people that you brought on? Like, how did that start?
Yeah, so, well, so the first incarnation of it was a little bit different. So I worked at Ableton in 2007, and then I became a certified trainer. And then after that, I started getting calls for to do big shows. Like I moved to Vegas and worked with Cirque du Soleil for 4 months in 2009.
That's very cool.
And I was just doing a lot of like consulting for artists and shows at that time. And it was shortly thereafter that I started working with Kanye. And around that time, it was definitely a lot of, I was doing a lot of master classes and workshops. And I had this master class that I did, and we decided to call it Electronic Creatives Presents, you know, this master class, right? So it was education stuff at first. And then in 2011, I got a call from the Weeknd's management, and they were like, hey, do you want to, can you go do on this tour with the Weeknd? And I was like, well, I would, but I'm touring with Kanye right now, and it conflicts with my schedule, but I'm a big fan. I love the Weeknd. I saw, you know, he was an up and coming artist. And I said, well, I've got this other guy that I can put out on this tour. And so I called up one of my friends, and I was like, hey, there's this tour with this artist called The Weeknd. They're like, who's that? You know? And so it's funny to think about now, but, and so I said, okay, do you want to go on tour? Sure. So we, it was like that. And then, you know, the next up was like the Yeah Yeah Yeahs hit me up, and they were like, hey, do you want to, you know, come do this tour? And I was like, well, I want to like get you guys going, and I want to design your show, because they wanted to do all these keyboard changes and sounds and patches and all that kind of stuff. So I set all of that up, and then I found this other guy, and I trained him, and was like, okay, here you go. You're going to be off on tour. So I just kind of kept doing that. I just kept like training people and putting them out on the road, and then
That's awesome.
It just grew and grew. Yeah.
I was watching a video that you have on your website, the Electronic Creative site, and it was a video promoting the Master Track training program in LA.
Yeah.
We can talk a little bit about that too if you want, but you gave those people the opportunity to do what they love and to be able to work with artists that they love. And that's kind of like a dream job for them. So I think it's really cool that you're doing that. And at the same time, you're building a network and building relationships with artists and giving them the opportunity to do what they've always wanted to do. I think that's really cool.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, no, I mean, it just, it's so amazing to have built this community and to be able to help people. I mean, there's nothing I love more than to be able to give back to people that really deserve it, and they work hard. And, you know, I don't want to like toot my own horn, but
oh no, please toot it. Go for it.
I mean, I've changed a few people's lives, you know. It's like they went from like, you know, doing like food delivery type stuff to like going on tour with like huge artists. So,
yeah,
you know, I just like love changing people's lives like that, and just like giving opportunities with like really smart, motivated people that just may have not had the right opportunity. So yeah, it's really cool.
I think that's fantastic that you're doing that. And everybody loves a good like starving artist success story, you know.
Oh yeah.
Like, I was a pizza delivery man carrying garbage out for a living, and now you get to travel around the world and hang out with really cool people.
Yeah. No, it's exciting. And then also through that, I've gotten a few of my my squad like opening positions, like not the first guy that I had with the Weeknd, but the second guy, he's been opening for the Weeknd for the last, you know, 2 years doing like electronic drumming. And
that's very
cool. So it's been like really cool, because when I first met him, he was like, yeah, I'm like drumming, but you know, I'm not making too much money at this. And like, you know, I want to do more. And that, and I was like, okay, here's this gig. Like, let's see where it'll take you. And
yeah.
And now he's like opening for the Weeknd in these huge arenas. So it's like, oh, yeah, it's so awesome. Yeah.
he's living the dream.
Yeah. It's cool.
So there's a couple things I also wanted to tap your brain on. The video for the Master Track program in LA, you had some really cool things that I wrote down, and I'm going to quote you on this.
Okay.
You were talking about, several myths of the music industry. And I found this really interesting. The first myth about the music industry is it's all about who you know. Just because you met some people and got your foot in the door doesn't mean you'll start landing gigs all the time. It's more so about the relationships you build, the communication, and the trust.
Oh, absolutely.
And that was good. That's worth going down in history books. I think that's a really good quote. And I kind of want to hear you expand a little bit on that.
Yeah, definitely. It's cool that you're bringing this up now, because I recorded that like a year ago, and I'm like, what did I say?
Blast of the past.
That's cool though. Yeah. No, I mean, I absolutely think that. Like, I mean, I feel like with my path and my career, like what I've been good at, I mean, besides music and tech, is like just building relationships and communication. I think that's what, you know, I pride myself on, is being really good at communicating needs for the artists and the clients and, you know, what we can build together. And a lot of people think, oh, well, I got these skills. I'm really technical and really musical. And, you know, I've got all these skills, like they should hire me. But at the end of the day, you have to be in a tour bus with these people. You have to be in close quarters with these people. And if you're not good at communicating, you're not a nice person to be around, you aren't a good person, getting hired is going to be challenging because it's such a small, close-knit community, mm-hmm. especially in the touring world. So that's what I meant by that. A lot of people like put themselves out there, but then they don't, you know, give back either, or they just expect to, you know, get given something and not have to like work as hard for it. Yeah. But I absolutely think it's really just about good energy, especially in the music industry.
Sure.
I can suss out, and other people can suss out in, you know, 1 minute whether or not this person is going to be a good hang. So I think it's super important to just like always be helping other people. Like we have this phrase in the touring world, like white glovers, like people that don't want to put in the work, you know. And, you know, there's a fine line there because you don't want to like step outside of your role.
Sure.
But you also want to be that person that's like, yeah, I got you. Like, you need help, I'll be there for you.
Right.
Versus, oh, I just finished my job and I'm just going to like, you know, go over here and do whatever and
yeah.
help out. So I think that's important. And all the people on my team, you know, really tried to train them and teach them to be that kind of person. And I think the people that I have already brought on my team, they have that innately, you know, they have that like, yeah, let me help you out. Like we've mm-hmm. never been the type of people that are like, oh, I'm not going to tell you my secrets or I'm not going to tell you what I'm doing, because
yeah.
it's important for us. You know, like, hey, there's all kinds of stuff out there, especially now on the internet, you know, that you can learn, but
yeah,
it's really about what kind of a person you are at the end of the day.
100% agree with that. I thought I knew a lot until I went to Loop this year. And and I was like, wow, there's a lot of people here that know way more than I do. And this is really cool. Like, I loved it.
Well, I mean, we're all continually learning. I mean, I've been Absolutely. Doing this for a while. I'm continually learning. There's so much out there. There's so much to know, you know, and mm-hmm. we're not always able to like focus on necessarily just learning all the new tech and new tools, especially when we're building a business and building, you know, like a personal brand and all that kind of stuff. There's so much that goes into all of that.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm constantly learning from people around me, and it's great because that's why I've built this community. It's like, oh, well, I don't know the answer to this question, but I can ask one of my team members and they've figured it out already, you know?
Yeah.
So that's cool. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And one of the things I loved in the opening ceremony, going back to Loop, was, you know, he talked about, he's like, yeah, there's all these technical things that we're going to talk about and learn. But in the end of the day, it's about the relationships that you have. And going back to your myth, you said the relationships you build, communication and trust, and being able to trust somebody, having clear communication, I feel like allows you to stay productive and also have fun in the process.
And absolutely.
In my experience, because music should be fun, right? Like we should be having a good time doing what we love, and being able to work with people that you trust, I feel like really cultivates that. And that's kind of what I'm hearing you say as well.
Absolutely. Oh yeah. I mean, it's really all about the trust factor for me, because, you know, I've brought people into my world and, you know, we're working with some very high profile artists. So
yeah.
you know, I have to have that trust to say, okay, I trust you to go out on this tour and not fan out. or
Just fangirling the whole time, wearing yeah. all the merchandise shirts, just like
well, cause stalking them. Some people, they don't know how to be cool in front of huge celebrities.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
that's definitely a factor.
That's a real thing. Yeah.
yeah.
Fangirling can be exhausting for a lot of artists. It's like, nah, just be real, man. Just be a real person.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We all sit down and poop the same way. That's what I tell my students. it's true.
Very true. Very true.
So another thing you said, the second myth you said about the music industry is you need an expensive music education. and one of the quotes you said around that, and you said, just because you know how to use audio software, Ableton Live or MIDI stuff, doesn't mean you know how it's being used in a professional touring world. This isn't something you can learn watching YouTube video tutorials.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's so interesting because there's a lot of people that know how to use Ableton Live and are very good producers. But what we do as live show programmers and playback engineers is like completely different from that. I mean, yes, you do use some of your skills as a producer. And like, if you are good at producing and making remixes and, you know, transitions and all that kind of stuff, it does come into play. But there's so many other nuances and things that you need to learn in order to do this job. And so I get a lot of people that are hitting me up. They're like, I know Ableton, let me come join your team. And I'm like, well, it's so much more than that. So I think, I mean, obviously you're reading the myths from something that I was recording to sell my master track course.
And you did a good job. I was sold. So, I was like, hey, I'm going to sign up. Take my money, take my wallet. You know.
Awesome. But yeah, I think it's, you know, it's important for some people to really, you know, understand that learning certain skill sets it's completely different from another skill set. And being on the road is a whole different ball of wax as well. And just like learning how to be that. I mean, I tell people sometimes it's not even about what you know about Ableton Live or production or anything like that. It's like how you're going to stand up on the road when you haven't been in a hotel for 3 days and, you know, you've been showering in an arena that's cold and, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, I think it's definitely true. There's, you know, there's definitely stuff out there in the world, but how you communicate with a musical director or the artist, in the moment, that's kind of stuff that you learn when you've been doing it, and it takes a little while. So the way we're using Ableton Live is completely different from any other way that you would normally use it. So especially in the playback world, there's a bunch of different nuances and things to, you know, think about. So
can you give us a couple examples, maybe on a technical level, like comparatively to, say, the average performing band who's playing, say, like venues of several hundred or maybe a couple thousand people at most versus these big, big productions? Like, what are some technical differences that maybe you can point out?
Well, I mean, just output wise, you know, so there's can be up to like 32 different outputs to front of house, and you have to be able to mix all of those separately. There's also time code for lighting and video. So everything that is in your session has to be synced up with that, and you have to send that out to them and make files for them and make sure that when you're editing, all of that stuff is still on point so that you don't totally screw them up in the end, because the lighting and video is completely contingent on what you're doing in the session. So if you make one wrong move, it can screw up the entire show. Redundancy, you know, being able to know what to do if the A machine goes down or the A interface goes down, that's a huge thing. Just being able to make clicks and cues and slates and all that kind of stuff for the band, and like being in tune with what the band needs. And also a lot of times we're doing auto tune or vocal effects for the artist, and so making sure that all of those things are changing at the right moment. And you know, there's sometimes hundreds of stems in the session, and, you know, just making sure, and tons of songs. I mean, Kanye has got, you know, I don't even know, like 50 songs or something in the session, maybe even more. So just keeping track of all of these songs in one session, making sure it's all organized, having the different versions of songs. So like, you know, the version if Drake's there, the version if Drake's not there, the version if like Nicki Minaj shows up for Monster, or she doesn't, or whatever. So there's like all different kinds of like versions of songs, and keeping all that stuff straight. And then also like beyond that, just keeping all the controllers straight and like making sure those are redundant, and, you know, just making sure that you're safe on stage. And if anything were to happen, the show could keep going, because, you know, the worst thing that in this world, I mean, I've heard about playback engineers at like Madison Square Garden for this one artist, not from my team, but someone else, they just the show just stopped, you know?
Oh, no.
It was like, for 10 minutes, there was no music.
Awkward.
And that's like, you know, that's like the end of your career. Or like stuff like Ashley Simpson, SNL, you know? People don't really realize
that
that's a playback engineer in the background, you know, that may or may not have, you know, had her vocals in the track or triggered it or whatever. So there's like the playback engineer programmer has like got a really, really big job. And there's just like so many things to keep track of and so many different people to communicate with in the moment during the show. And if you can't be thinking about 10 different things at one time, this is not the gig for you, because you've got all different kinds of people talking to you. You've got all different kinds of edits to make. You've got, you know, redundancy to think about. You've got all this gear and you got to be musical.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's just a ton of stuff to think
about. Yeah, for sure. Lots of coffee and staying as focused as possible.
Yes.
That kind of transitions into the myth number three that I wrote down. And it says you have to choose between being a musician and an engineer. And you were talking about, you know, being able to be versatile, I guess, in that sense. And one of the things you talked about, music programming can be very creative. So, you know, and you even talked in the video a little bit about the guy that was working with The Weeknd from your team, and how he was a musician, but he also kind of was into the music programming thing, and now he gets to do the best of both. So maybe talk a little bit about the process. Like, what is the biggest advantage of being, I guess, a musician and an engineer and like into music programming? Like, how do those things all really come together?
Yeah, definitely. Well, so I would like to say that, you know, I like to think before I came around, things were a little bit more boring. No, but really, it was actually, I can't take the credit for it, but Ableton Live, you know, with the advent of Ableton Live and bringing that into the live show world, when I first started doing this, most people were using Pro Tools. Great software program for recording a band, but for doing a live show, not so great. And so, you know, people still joke and they're like, oh, you're pressing spacebar. And we're like, no, actually, we're using controllers. But they still call it spacebar, right? Okay, so you're pressing spacebar. And people would literally used to press two spacebars at once to sync two computers, right? Before like MIDI and controllers and all this kind of stuff. So when I came around and started like implementing Ableton Live into these shows, you know, it was like a completely new thing. And me being an artist as well, and being a one woman show and playing in bands and like, you know, doing all of that, it was kind of like, wow, well, why can't this position, why can't this job be more creative, you know? And so I started pushing it that way more. Like, you know, I've performed with a bunch of the different artists that I've worked with. I toured with Miguel as his DJ / programmer. So I was like playing all of the tracks live on stage with him, and I was opening for him as well.
Very cool.
Got to, you know, do my thing with controllers, and, you know, did shows with like Charlie XCX and Iggy Azalea and Kaiza. And,
awesome.
You know, so I definitely, as much as possible, have you know, put myself out there to be more than just the space bar, you know, quote person, because I'm a creative and I'm an artist as well. So I've definitely been busting that myth as much as possible everywhere I can go. And same thing with my team. You know, we definitely know when we're supposed to hang back and we're, you know, we're not trying to be the stars, right? The stars are the stars, the artists are the artists. But we also have a lot to bring to the table. And for me, as a producer, as an artist, like, you know, I made tons of suggestions, especially when I toured with Kanye. And, you know, I would always be having ideas. Like, I composed the intro to the Dark Fantasy tour, which the first show was Coachella in 2011. And I played violin and I recorded it and I brought it to him and his team. And, you know, they were like, wow, oh, okay, cool. Let's use this for the show opener. I was like, amazing.
Yeah.
So just stuff like that. Or like, you know, when I was in New York at Madison Square Garden on the Watch the Throne tour, you know, I came up with all these different like New York based songs and like made some remixes and like transitions into, you know, their songs and like played them for them. And, you know, so that those moments were really cool because I get to incorporate my musicality and then show them what I can do. And a lot of people that are programmers and playback engineers aren't necessarily as musical. They're more of a technical people. So I think most everyone on my team is both musical and technical, and I try to curate those kinds of people so that we can be more than just the pressing the space bar person. We can offer up our own creative suggestions, and we can rock the controllers on stage if we need to. So that's been, you know, it's been really fun for me to like bust that myth, because I think you know, there was this box, and for a while I was like, why does this box exist? And it was like, oh, because people are so used to the Pro Tools linear style of performing. Mm-hmm. They're not actually, they're not hip to what you can do now with controllers. Yeah.
That is very true. I mean, there's so many controllers out there too, you know, and you have so much versatility with just even like an APC 40, you know, which I think I've seen you use before in some of the videos. And do you have a favorite controller that you typically kind of stick with for live performance in that scenario?
I love my Ohm RGB.
Okay.
Livid Instruments Ohm, and then my Push. Those are like my two main go-to controllers.
Do you use the Push more for live performance, or do you use it more for production, or is it kind of a 50 split?
You know, at first I was just using it for production, but now I've actually gotten really into using it live, especially with something called CliffX, the scripting language. Yeah, for changing the scales on the Push, like in the moment. And I talked about that at Loop during my presentation, and some people were like, oh my gosh, you just opened a door that I didn't even know existed.
Bink Beats was talking about that for his set as well. Very, very cool. I had somebody who was brand new to Ableton the other day. It was like, I want to learn CliffX. I was like, no, dude, don't do it. You got a little bit ways to go. It's a black hole, but it's cool. You can do so much. You can really hack Ableton with it. It's awesome.
Definitely.
Cool. We're running a little bit short on time. I wanted to basically ask you, if you had to give advice to our listeners who wanted to say they're like a more experienced in Ableton, more developed with production, and they wanted to start getting in a little deeper into music programming for live performance, whether it was for themselves or for other bands, what would be some of your suggestions to them?
I mean, again, I don't want to just promote my
own please
stuff,
do. That's why I asked you to join. So
but
this is your time.
You know, okay. So MasterTrack, that's the program for playback engineers. I really don't think there's anything else out there like this right now. And so that's why, you know, I'm just going to talk about it, because I think it's really, really valuable. Last week, it was 2 weeks in LA. It was just, we had a bunch of Ableton certified trainers there. A few of the people just went on to work for my company and started touring with like Ariana Grande and Mariah Carey and Big Sean. And so that was like that was really cool to see them kind of level up their skills. And they already knew how to use Ableton Live, but after going through the program, they're like, okay, I'm ready for this, because they just needed that extra training. So MasterTrack, we just have the dates held. It's going to be March 18th, that week this year after South By. I'm going to be at South By Southwest.
Oh,
too,
nice.
Speaking.
Congrats, cool.
Thanks. Yeah. And so, yeah, MasterTrack is going to be coming up. So that's for people that want to tour and be playback engineers. And then I also have a new online course that I'm launching next month, and it's called Transmute Accelerator. And it's a little bit of a different track. So it's more for live performers who want to level up their live show, that maybe instrumentalists or DJs or singers who have been doing a certain thing and they want to use more technology and want to become more sophisticated in their offerings for live performances.
Fantastic.
So it's like it's a 2-month online course. There's going to be a community-based part of it. So people are we're going to be performing online and giving each other feedback, and I'll be popping in and doing like a group thing once a week, and a bunch of videos to watch and check out. So I'm really excited about that. That's like the first time I've ever done anything online. like that. And it's shaping up. I've got a few really, really cool people that have already signed up, and I'm like amazed. I'm like, oh, this is gonna be so fun. We're just gonna like all nerd out on our live shows, and I'm sure I'm gonna learn some stuff. Yeah. And yeah, it's gonna be great. So
that's very cool.
Yeah, those are the two kinds of like educational things that I'm
doing.
So
where can people go to find out more about both those things?
So on my website, on my personal website for Transmute, it's lauraescudé.com/transmute. Or if you just go to the website, you can find the link there. And then the master track will be on the Electronic Creatives website. So we'll be updating that soon with like the new dates and all that kind of stuff. But I think for both, you know, we've got email list signups on both pages. Cool. And then, of course, we're on Instagram. I've got my personal Instagram and then the EC Instagram. So we'll be announcing all the stuff on the Instagrams and keeping people
updated. All the social media stuff. Yeah, thank you for joining. Like, I want to respect your time. I know you have to go, but thank you so much for joining. Everybody go check out Laura and her master track, and go check out the new course she was talking about. Follow her on Twitter and Instagram and all that social media stuff. Thanks again, Laura, for joining. I think you shared a lot of really cool knowledge that I'm going to be able to like take home for myself, as well as I'm sure everybody else listening. So
awesome. Thanks for having
absolutely.
Me.
Best of luck. Enjoy the warm weather in LA, and we'll maybe have you back another time in the future.
That'd be great.
For sure. Thanks a lot. Have a great weekend.
All right.
Take it easy.
You too.
Thanks. This podcast is sponsored by liveproducersonline.com, a community of Ableton Live users connecting you to the pros to learn today's music production.